Alright, so it's probably going to be a long vlog tonight, but yeah, I wanted to talk about so many things. I'm here with the Indian dilemma. I am a Native American Indian. Now, I've newly discovered, going back to Mayan, Aztec, and Inca. So because I am Inca, that's very exciting actually. Because when I first started this blog venture out here on the internet, one of my very first videos is Rudela. I came out here with the feather on my head with a headdress. And it was just natural for me. I'm like, oh, I'm going to hit the internet and I'm going to go out there with my Indian self. And then I end up finding that I'm Indian. So it was very exciting for me. And I know you probably supposed to say Native American now to be, you know, not juxtaposed with other names. But it's very interesting because in all of this time, many things have been happening. Many things. So I paint, you know, sometimes. And my choice of painting has been with the feathers. So I painted only with feathers. I didn't try brushes of American made or somewhere else or some other type of animal, just out of the duck feathers. So I am very much into the bird feathers as my tool, as my natural instinct. And so I'm sitting here going, well, okay, natural instinct. It has to do with your indigenous self. Your instinctual self lies in these things. If you allow yourself to go to touch base with it, if you allow yourself that freedom, you know, even with symbols, you know, what is your preferred symbol? You know, I'm looking at many of the carpets here in the house that are my father's choosing. And many of them are this, it's like the geometric Mezzo-Colombian design of the pyramid, the square pyramids of the Mayans and the Incas and the Aztecs. So many of the carpets are that way. They're with that design. And that's very odd. That would be his choice. But that's been his choice, you know, for many years. So now I'm like thinking about my father because he's an odd creature. He's been an odd creature like his whole life and been like, oh my gosh, he is like, in a way fierce, and I'm intimidated by him, and you know, my whole life. And so in a way he's like a chief. He is like an Indian chief. And it's all starting to coalesce and make sense that I have a grumpy Indian chief here in the house. And I'm like, well, this is it. We'll make this a reservation. This is going to have to be Indian land. You know, where I am right now. If he is 1/6, it came out that he is 1/6 Indian, my gosh, he's a chief then. And then I am just, you know, part of the tribe who has to really kind of run the orders of whatever he says. And all of that was going on swell before the Catholics took over, before the Spanish took over. They went over in their little boats. The Spanish went la 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 and say, huh? You think you are the chief? Not anymore. There is God. And because no more animus. The animus was the religion. The zoolatry was a religion. The animus is the taking of the feather, the picking up of the feather. I'll take a very beautiful one. Is to select these feathers, and it is the continuance of the being of that creature. It is the embodiments gathered. The remembrance, and also the continuance. So it gives you the vision self, if you understand what I mean. If you wanted to be shaman, it gives you the vision self moment. You can meditate into it. You can go, yes, this beautiful feather here, that bird, I want to become in tune with that bird. And lastly, we have the great bird dances. There was a beautiful bird dance that I watched in Alaska. I may have even said this already. It was so beautiful. And he was all in white Parmesan feathers. That was unbelievable. And it really was an embodiment self in the dance. He was an embodiment of the bird, you know, without any self-consciousness, afflictions. So when we're looking at this, here comes a Spanish ship again, and he said, no, you don't have the animus any longer, you have God. Well, my gosh, weak man, all men are weak, you know, by the just of God. And in that sentiment, well, the men don't have any place to put it anymore, so what do? They attack their women, they attack other men. So it has not been good for the society to have this, well, it's just as God, and the rest of you are just lackeys, you are just minuses. And my father tonight even says, who am I, blah, 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 you know, this. He's into this this martyrdom self, and I'm like, that is brought on, you know, I'm telling you, that is brought on by Catholicism, that is brought on by the church, that derogatory into your ego, derogatory. All right, so anyway, so we're looking at symbols and what you do in your life. You know, are you attracted? Are you a collector? Do you collect pine cones? And you're like, why do I collect pine cones for? And everybody else doesn't. And so maybe goes back into your natural indigenous self. This is what we're trying to find. Okay. Now this is something, you know, my father and my mother collected through their hippie years. Okay, now this is a very interesting. It's a piece that has mirrors, has little mirrors on it, and the sewing. I'll try to get it closer. I know it's a terrible camera, but the sewing of itself, it's a star, isn't it? It has stars. So it's very important to have all of these stars. And we're going back to when we're into the Incas. Now because I'm descendant of Inca, the Incas themselves, they were the ones, direct descendants from the aliens from outer space. So because they are descendants of the aliens from outer space, well, so am I. And that is swell to find out. I wish I knew this earlier. I feel jilted that I didn't know before. Why did I have to wait 50 plus years to find out that I'm an alien from outer space? Also, I feel like I missed my stardom moment. I could have carried that drama inside me, you know, with every breath I take, you know, every place I go. You know, how fun. Until you realize, no. The Incas were the one who went through the square portal. And then so now I'm like, dang it, couldn't I have gone through one that was beautiful and swirly and more like Celtic looking? But no, it's exactly square, a rectangle door, portway. Perfect, absolutely perfect in its dimensions. It's perfect in its finesse of the way it was built. But it does say something about where I come from. That organization of perfection, that demand you know, that demand of perfection, you know, still exists because I'm Inca. So it goes through that portal and, well, so yeah, so I can look at this now and go, well, I can criticize it pretty bad. Or I can say, you know, I can make a little white lie and pretend it's just okay or beautiful or whatever. But yeah, I can find fault. And I see that as a square portal people, or the rectangle portal people, that we find fault. We're capable of finding fault. And that brings on the competitive self. It brings on all kinds of things, doesn't it? So, well, so not only does this ancestor.com or whatever it was, ancestry.com test tell me that I am an Aztec and I need more chocolate, it is telling me that I'm an alien just from outer space. So I'm like, wow, way cool. And then at the brooks of all of this, I'm like, okay, fine, I'll seek out on the internet tonight again. And apparently there are 7 million supposed descendants of the original Mayans alive today. So I guess I'm added to the list. But yeah. Very interesting. So in a way this explains things, because like when I tan, and this, I know this is a personal moment, but yeah, when I tan, I don't, on my arms, they turn brown, and I'm like, well, wait a minute. I thought I was like the white woman from England and France, and then I end up being like the brown skin. And so those types of things, and no freckles, you know. So anyway. It's fun to be an Indian, a Native American. Now there are many, there, when I'm looking at my great-great-grandmothers and my great-great-grandfathers, that's the list, you know, there's about 16 of them. And in that list, one of those was Indian, 100%. Now, one of them, it was named Modesto in the middle name, meaning, and that is the name of an Indian tribe, so it could be a Modesto Indian. That's interesting to remember. And we also have to consider that their names, being adopted into Catholicism, because we're talking really heavy, heavy Catholicism at that time, being adopted into, they would have changed their Indian name away and become straight up into Jesucristo. So you're not gonna see the Cherokee there. You're not gonna see that tribe finality name, or you know the little 2 foot creek water. Runner, you're not gonna see that name. You're gonna see, you know, that. So that was odd, Modesto. But I look it up, and it just means modest. So that goes back to European origin of modesty, which is another thing flanked with religion. So and the frugality of life that you have to be. Or else, you know, it's all God. You might as well just give everything to God, and the rest is your penance for being born. So yeah. So in a way, Modesto, I'm gonna actually say no, that he was not the Indian, as much as I wanted to. I'm gonna say no. I don't believe he came from the Modesto tribe. Now I do have a great great grandfather. And his face is really, really dark, and it's a dark red tone, like, and I'm like, oh my gosh, what is he? And they're like mestizo, I guess they call them, or there's the mestizo tribe, very, very dark red. dark red face. Anyway, so back to the Indian, I called it the Indian notation moment, because back to my dad, because he is the most Indian that I can acknowledge, and he is the most like secure with being his Indian self. Now, barefoot, often in his life, indoors or outdoors, and I'm not kidding, he will just open up the door to the front of the house and walk out barefoot onto the pavements. And the people are like, who are you? You know, who are you? What would you do that for? You know, even in the winter, you know, are you insane? So it's very comfortable for him to be barefoot. So that's part of his indigenous self. So all of these little moments, you have to look up and find out where's your indigenous self. So he's easy in a way. He's an easy chief to find because he does these odd things. Okay, so now when I'm like, what else does he do? Well, he does. He picks up all of these feathers. A classic beachcomber for many years. He could not stop. He was addicted to collecting seashells, addicted to collecting feathers. Unbelievable amounts of feathers. And I'm like, I can't believe you're collecting all of those feathers. What do we need all these feathers for? And yet, I can't say that because over in France, I spent years, in a way, collecting feathers myself from my ducks, my birds. When they fall I would just spend hours collecting feathers. So it is part of my natural habit is to collect feathers. So that's very interesting. So that's part of the indigenous person, the indigenous self. And that can point to a tribe, I'm sure, instantly. Some tribes maybe are like, no, we're not the collectors of the feathers. And others will be, oh, no, we are. We can't stop. You know, we are addicted to it. And so then I can write that down, and maybe then there is possibly that is my related tribe, one of you guys. Okay, so what else? Okay, so back to my father himself. We go to Ima Sumac, you know, these wonderful singers. She's out there in the Amazon jungle making her wild cries and sing songs of the birds. Now that's her, you know, that's her indigenous self, you know, she's not afraid of it. Now likewise, my father's very similar. He sees animals, he makes these animal hoots and sounds and woo-woos and loud and attractions to them, and not in a space of I scare the dog away or scare that cat away. It's very much an equality moment, a space and time with just him and the animal, sharing their being space. You know, like he wants to be along the same wavelength as that animal. So that's very much an indigenous moment. So, okay, now did I miss anything about him? Oh my gosh, I'm sure I did. I think I wrote a few other things down on the list. The running. I'm sorry. He prefers to run instead of walk. And that's very interesting. He is a long-time runner, and I mean jogger. In his life, at work, he would go to San Francisco like almost every day, and it'd be 6 o'clock in the morning before he went to make furniture plans or whatever. He would jog 6 o'clock, 5 o'clock, 5:30 in the morning. He would jog the streets of San Francisco, run. from his car to the work. And I'm like, you know, that's just insane. Why would you do that? Why don't you just, you know, park closer? And why, you know, so for me, it's not, I've lost that. I'm not that indigenous self anymore of the runner-jogger. But he is still doing this, and he's 80 years old, and he is running up the mountain. And I, you know, I'm like getting, you know, I'm here as caregiver. I'm supposed to like be like, make sure he's okay. And so I have to go like chase after him in a car sometimes, you know, make sure he has water or you know, put something to drink or eat. But he is fine. He is a long distance jogger type. So that comes from the indigenous self. And that's a person that is comfortable with it. And he, and oddly, he will not wear jogging outfit. He will not wear jogging clothing. That, I don't know. I can't, nobody can get him to wear jogging suits. So he will only jog in regular outfits. So he's mildly annoying to everybody because we want him in the jogging outfit. But that's the way it goes. There's nothing you can do. You know, a person that wants to be that way, they're that way. But all in all, he is a chief. We just don't know what tribe. That's where we're at right now. We just don't know the exact tribe. And that is the big miss we're having with this ancestry. Yes, of course, all the tribes eventually, you know, they stemmed from, you know. Going back into certain regions, and ours definitely a lot points to the Mexico, a lot points to Mexico, but that doesn't discount Guatemala either, and it doesn't discount Peru. So it's very, very interesting finding. So now, I did one vlog search for all of you, for your learner brain, that the feathers, they weren't just beautiful feathers that they wore. Many times the feathers were, you know, there they are in the camp, they're in their tents, they're in their wigwams. The feathers themselves were often cut a certain way. So if the feather is cut, you have a chunk out here, it could mean that you had scalped someone in war. So feathers are not just like Mrs. Nice and Mr. Nice here. They're very, very serious. If it's cut a certain way, you've been to a war many times, or has all these different meanings. You know, you've killed in battle. They put red on it. It means you actually have killed. So yeah, the feathers themselves, very serious. All right, everybody. So yeah, so look around your houses. Look at things you've collected in your life as you just can't resist. And oddly, I can't really when it comes to collectibles like little tiny porcelain rabbits or I guess you can include them also. Why not? They have the mischief of being the Europeanized first. But you can absolutely, I don't see why you could not include them. My mother collected she collected the porcelain rabbits and the porcelain squirrels, whole bunches of them. And glass. She was a glassaholic. So all of these things, glass animals. Yeah. So look at what your parents have collected, what symbols You know, they have in their carpets, in their sofas, their pillows that they purchase. Yeah. And it may help, you know, may help direct you to where you are, Indian-wise, Native Indian, on the planet. Yeah. Some of you may head straight to Egypt, and some will go, well, no, we're just hanging around in France, down in that lazo, in the caves. All right, guys, that's enough. I did sing a lot tonight, I know.